In this subunit, we'll learn how to calculate the dimension of certain mathematical fractals. To start, we'll consider some really simple shapes: line segments, squares, and cubes. And by considering these shapes, we'll see how to generalize our intuitive idea of dimension so it can apply in some interesting and important ways to fractals. So our starting point for thinking about dimensions is to think about how many small copies of a shape fit inside a big copy. And I'm going to make a table here that I'll fill out, and we're going to do three simple examples. To start by thinking about a line segment. So suppose I have a line segment like this. And then suppose I have a line segment that's three times as long. One, two, three. And I ask how many of the small line segments fit inside this line segment that's stretched by three. And the answer is three. One, two, three little line segments inside this big line segment. So for the shape of a line, magnification factor of three, the number of small copies in a big copy is three. And so what I mean by magnification factor here is that I need to take a small copy and magnify it three times, stretch it three times in this direction in order to have it be the same size as the large shape, this large line segment. Okay. So much for a line segment. Now, let's think about a square. So here's a small square. Imagine this is a square with a side of one, for instance. And then what if I had a square that had a side of three? And I could ask, how many of these little squares fit in here? And if I draw it in like this, we can see that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 little squares fit inside the big square. This hand drawing isn't perfect. The idea is that this size is this square is the same size as that. So there are 3 times 3 equals 9 small squares in this big square, and the big square is magnified by a factor of 3, right? It's stretched by 3 in this direction, 3 in that direction. So going back to my table, the shape of a square, magnification factor of 3, number of small copies in the big copy is 9. All right, let's think about one more shape, cube. So here's a little cube. Again, cube has a side of 1. And now suppose we have a cube that's three times as large. It's always a little bit challenging for me to draw. Okay, so how many of these small cubes fit inside this cube? Let me draw on some lines that will maybe make it a little clearer. Okay, not a perfect drawing, but I hope it illustrates the point. So let's think about how many small cubes are in this big cube. Well, in this top layer, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then there's another layer or slice here, another 9, and another 9 here on this bottom slice. So 9 plus 9 plus 9 gives me 27. So there are 27 small cubes in this larger cube. And the magnification factor, again, is 3. To go from this small cube, or this small cube here, to the big one, I need to magnify the entire shape by 3, meaning that it's 3 times as long, 3 times as deep, and 3 times as high. So I can complete this table now. So the last shape was a cube. The magnification factor is 3, And the number of small copies in the big copy is 27. So let's see what we can learn from this table. So the question is, what geometric property or feature of these shapes determines what goes over here? Determines how many small copies go in the big copy, because the magnification factor for all of these is the same. So the answer to this question is that it's the dimension. Lines, squares, and cubes have a different dimension, and so the numbers that appear over here are different. So let me write down the relationship between this and this using the dimension. So here's an equation that relates magnification factor to the number of small copies in a big copy of a shape. So the equation is that the number of small copies equals the magnification factor raised to the d power. And d in this equation is the self-similarity dimension. And I'll just call it the dimension for short now, since there's no other dimension around to be thinking about. So let's think about this. What is it telling us? So let's start with a square first. So square has a magnification factor of 3. And the number of small copies in the big copy is 9. And so then what d would that be? Let's go back here. So number of small copies is 9. And the magnification factor is 3. So we wonder, OK, what's the dimension? Well, d would have to be 2, because 9 is 3 squared. So we'll say that the square has a dimension of 2. And that makes sense. That's consistent with our intuitive idea of dimension. A square has an extent in one and two directions. So we think of a square as two-dimensional. We can do a similar thing with a cube. Let's do the cube first. So the magnification factor, the number of small copies we decided was 27. And that's going to be the magnification factor to the dimension d. And so we see that in this case, so d is 3. So the cube is three-dimensional. And that's consistent with our notion of dimension. 1, 2, 3 directions for a cube. So we'll say it's three-dimensional. And we can do the same thing with a line. This equation's a little bit boring. Number of small copies in the line segment is 3. And the magnification factor is 3. So what's the exponent? Well, 3 to the 1. Remember that a number raised to the first power is just that number, right? So x to the 1 is just x, for instance. So this says that the dimension of a line is 1. So going back to this picture, this is the key equation for this unit. Magnification factor to the d is the number of small copies, and d is a dimension. This is maybe an unusual way of thinking about dimension, but it does tell us that lines are one-dimensional, squares are two-dimensional, and cubes are three-dimensional, like we would expect. So in the next video, we'll look at applying this idea of dimension to a fractal. But before we do that, I'll suggest doing a quick quiz just to practice this formula to make sure you see how it works.